Well, interesting things that people do, that's for damn sure. And so 10,000 feet, I guess, is the flight altitude of a commercial airliners, right? So that's something like 35, 36,000 feet, I guess. So they've got s captions, so I guess I'm not sure I need to narrate it, but I guess the one good thing doing this out of a plane is he does have a parachute. So if something goes wrong, that's not his. He's hoping that it won't, but if something goes wrong, then I guess you've got a parachute to rely on. So in our first week, I guess we did the calculation for pressure and know that at that kind of altitude, there's 10,000 meters, which is Everest. There's I'm not sure how much the pressure was. It's pretty low. It was less than 50%, I think, right? Because it's exponential, asymptotes to zero as you get into the space and the stratosphere. And so yeah, so I guess the comment that comes next is kind of interesting. Not that one. It's British pounds. Greetings. How you doing? Oh, perhaps he already said it. He said that when they landed, he said he just jumped from 10,000 feet, and some guy in a pickup truck came past him and said, "Yep, yeah, okay, fine, see you later." Just as it was, as if it was super matter of fact. So anyway, so that's that. What else have we got? Don't want to do lift. Oh yeah, this is interesting as well. So, week nine, you talked about dimensional analysis. So you can use models to represent behavior and then scale them and scale the forces on those models to represent forces on real things. And so one of the things you have to get right is that kinematic similitude means that you run the model at the same Reynolds number, essentially. And so at the same Reynolds number, the flow regime around the model and the prototype would, if you took a snapshot of this, these smoke streak lines would look exactly the same in model and prototype. So this is clearly not a wing the size of a plane, but in a small, I'd imagine, a small wind tunnel. And you can see what the flow lines across go. And of course, lift is due to the fact that we've talked about it on the top of the wing. The surface is slightly longer on than on the base of the airfoil relative to its aspect. And so to go from up the leading edge to the trailing edge, the fluid has to go faster to be able to join up with its buddy on the bottom. And therefore, from Bernoulli, if you speed up, you drop pressure. If you have larger pressure below than above, then it'll lift. If the wing becomes too inclined, then it doesn't really provide any lift, and that's not what you want in the plane that you're sitting in, because it will stall and whoops, drop out of the sky, which is probably what you don't want to happen. These are Wikipedia's rocks blowing across Death Valley. I'm not sure why that's here. Yeah, you see the same thing in perhaps more modern situations, and of course for cars to be economical with energy, whether it's gasoline or electricity, you want to reduce the drag. And I suppose you'd like to have some negative lift that pulls it down onto the ground, or perhaps pushes it down on the ground by the airflow that goes over the top. Formula One now has changed, I think, right? The cars used to be these super sleek things. They hugged the ground and they used to create a slight under pressure underneath them and have fins on them that physically stuck them to the ground. And I guess Formula One decided that that wasn't very entertaining for people to watch because there was it's too preordained as to who would win just because you could go so fast. And so they've changed it to have less superstructure pushing down it. Ford GT40, classic car, I think, right? And so you can use wind tunnels in the same way to do that. What else as we go across here? Yes, it's kind of interesting as well. So, guy taking his plane out of the hangar using his Massey Ferguson. I guess Massey Harris, I guess it's Massey Ferguson, I thought, is the farming company that made these tractors, perhaps as a precursor to that. And so what's being used here is the idea that you can, instead of using a wind tunnel, you can actually just stick these little telltales on them. They'd be telltales if they're on a sail, on a sailing boat, because you can see which way the wind is blowing across your sail, etc. But he's using it to be able to look at the airflow out of his window as he flies the plane. And so that's probably kind of the airflow you'd like, perhaps less that, right? At the trailing edge of the back of the wing, you've got some almost reverse circulation or vortices that are developing as you mess around with the ailerons, which is just, he's messing around with here. And I don't know whether he's trying to get it to stall in real life, but he's just, no, fine. So on some wings, you see these things that guide the flow over the top of them specifically. And I'm not sure what else is he's trying to do here. Yeah, so if the angle of attack becomes too high, then the wing so-called stalls, because the flow here is not in the direction you might think it is. It's going backwards across the wing, right, ahead of you. And so that circulation kills lift because it's you're getting this strange flow. And so when we talk about stuff today, we'll kind of review some things first, but today we'll probably talk about external flows. And of course, this is an external flow. It's the same external flow as watching some race taking off from Le Havre in France, going across the Atlantic to the Southern Ocean, and then back to Martinique in the Caribbean. And these boats are amazing. They're all hydrofoils, but a wing on a sail on a boat is not really very different from a wing on a plane. And so the same principles apply. And we'll be able to explore kind of what those are in this segment. What else do I have? I think this person does actually try and stall the wing. We'll see. Perhaps not. Oh yeah, yeah. So same deal. Change the angle of attack, all of a sudden you get reverse circulation under it. And I'm trying to think what the last one is. I guess I didn't cut the sound on that. But maybe the last one, oh yeah, this is kind of cool. I watched You Only Live Twice. Of course, James Bond is a bit misogynistic, but I think it comes from a different time. Better, it's actually humorous, but it is kind of bizarre. But anyway, in James Bond, I think in You Only Live Twice, or, they had an autogyro. And this is a version of that, as you'll see, if I cut the sound. So an autogyro is like a helicopter, has a blade above it, and a big propeller behind it driving it. But unlike a helicopter, the blade isn't driven, and like in this car, the blade is not really driven. It's probably driven just by exhaust from the engine, which comes up through this assemblage here into this rotor, what on helicopters, I think, in the military, they call the Jesus bolt, because if you lose it, you're kind of done for with the rotors coming off the plane. You can soft land in a helicopter if you lose power, not if you lose the blades, because it rotates as a wing. So this wing isn't providing enough power to be able to physically lift it like a helicopter, but is providing enough exhaust to turn it a little bit, so it acts as a wing. So as you're flying forward, on average, you have a wing that's moving at some reasonable speed. And if you get enough forward velocity, then you can take off. So I can't remember, I'm not sure, is it called UCAR? It's some acronym for car and flying car or something. And so it's like an autogyro, which has certainly been around for, well, You Only Live Twice must be 70 years old, right? No, perhaps 60s or 70s. So probably 50 years old. So autogyros have been around for a long time. And so you can land somewhere and then you can just drive the rest of your way to work, I guess, is the kind of idea. So kind of futuristic. Oh, it took more than I planned for that. And that's the last of the candy shots, I think, for there. So that's that. So what do we have today? Those are the videos. Actually, I was going to do something else, so why not? you're working long and hard in this course. I was kind of out of town doing some things, and you might be curious if we look to see what those things were that were being done. Well, it's dangerous to be able to show people your personal photograph connection. You never know whether you might have some bizarre things in there. But I went to Beijing, and I gave a talk at a meeting, which is interesting for me because it was to 119,000 people, which I thought was bizarre. So 10% on Beaver Stadium at satellite locations around the country. So that was a first for me, probably never to be repeated. I also went onto the Silk Road, and this is interesting. This is a town called Lanzhou. It's the beginning of the Silk Road in China. But what's interesting in this, not on this trip, but from pre-COVID, were these figures, and some of them. So this may well be the first place where water power was used. I can imagine this being 1,000 years ago in China. This is the Yellow River. Goes through at some ridiculous rate through this town, I think called the River of Sorrow in China, because it's spawned floods with many hundreds of thousands of deaths over the year. But the main distinction for this place is these water wheels. So this is being driven by some fins on the outside of the water wheel in the river. It turns it as the river goes downstream. It also lifts up a bucket, and then it lifts this bucket up into the superstructure, and then it dumps it into this. So, don't know, the videos here, maybe not. Just that one we showed. Perhaps this will do it. So yeah, you can see it. So the river's going this way, it's pushing it so it turns this way, it's bringing buckets of water up against these paddles, and then it dumps it into this little trough, and then it goes zipping off to somewhere else. So Lanzhou. The main reason for being there was to go. In the Gobi Desert is where the Silk Road goes through. These are beautiful pictures from a little oasis in there, reflections of autumn colors. But the real reason for going there was to go, perhaps I don't have, it was the day after this, I don't see it, was to go to a town maybe next door where the Chinese are trying to put their nuclear waste, their Yucca Mountain. So this is Gobi Desert, camels roaming around, nothing there, no water. Amazing that people 1,000 years ago used to get through that on the Silk Road. So I won't do that. And so, but now it does have lots of windmills, wind turbines, I guess. And you can't see very well here, but this is a tunneling machine. If you go 2.5 kilometers down at 1 in 10, you end up at a tunneling machine, which is digging a 7 meter wide tunnel into the ground on a spiral to be an experimental site for nuclear waste disposal. The place is called Baishan. Apparently this is Bai, as in Beijing, means North City. Bai means North, Shan means Tian Shan Mountains, North Mountain. And it's possibly a great site for a repository, a shaft going down at the same time. And it's in the middle of nowhere with a soccer pitch there. But it's a great site because you don't often, when you drill core, you don't bring out 10-meter lengths of core. Well, it's not 10 meters, that's 3-meter lengths, 10-feet lengths of core, which are completely intact, no fractures with water flowing in them. And so for a radioactive waste disposal site like Yucca Mountain, which it used to be in the U.S. in the Nevada desert, the agent by which it gets to humanity is by being carried in water. So if you can stop water flowing through it, then you have a fighting chance of being able to keep it in one place. So Yucca Mountain isn't commissioned these days because it's was kicked out during the Obama administration. Some people might say it was kicked out because Obama wanted to get Harry Reid on his side, who was a senator for Nevada, who didn't want Yucca Mountain there and was an influential voice on the Obamacare ballot. Do I have a picture here? So this is on the edge of the Himalaya, a place called Jinping. I don't think related to Xi Jinping, but just the same name. Jinping 2 Dam. It's the highest arch dam in the world. We talked about Malpasset Dam when we talked about fluid pressures on structures. that failed because the abutments gave way. This is looking downstream from the crest of the dam. You can see, I guess, the shadow of the dam there as it goes downstream. It's apparently in the Guinness Book of Records as being the highest thin-walled arch dam in the world. And the reason for being there was not because of the dam, but it was because, as in other places around the world, there's a very deep physics lab. So physicists want to understand what neutrinos are and measure them and look at them colliding off other particles. And if you want to do that, you have to be in a place where there's very low background radiation from the sun. And so this lab at 2,400 meters below the ground surface is a river here that flows downstream along here in a big oxbow. And the dam is here. There are tunnels which go across the mountain, it's about 10 kilometer path. And so it takes the water from here and drops it to a lower level in the reservoir, in the river. And I guess I do have some pictures. I thought I had some pictures of that on the dam surface. Yeah, here. So this is the idea. It comes in from 10 kilometers away. It's going downstream. It comes to the lower river. It comes through turbine holes. It comes along these pipes at high velocity. You have these towers here because if you shut the valves on the pipes, all of a sudden the water piles up with its momentum and it has to go somewhere. So if you don't want infinitely reinforced strong gates, you have to have some place for it to expand. And of course you know that if you shut the gates, the natural location it will rise to will be the height of the water in the upper reservoir. And so you have to have something there. And I think it has 8 turbines, it's 8 gigawatts, which is 8, you know, thermal power stations that you'd see in Pennsylvania that run through the turbine hole and then go downstream. And so this is a way to be able to short circuit that and have a maximum power drop. You know also in this class that the power you generate is mass flow rate times gravity times G. G doesn't change, gravity doesn't change, but mass flow rate, the more fluid you can get through, and the height differential that you have between upstream and downstream makes a difference in all of this. And so this is this underground physics lab. And so this is the tail race that goes through it with the water in it. These are access tunnels that get you from one side to the other. And these are a series of underground caverns, which look like pre-COVID, they looked like this in 2019. With big constructions going on inside them to be able to put physics experiments. And now they just look like an office building underground. So they look like this, like going into the office, nothing more, all kitted out. And so it's probably the biggest volume of one of these labs in the world. There's one in the US at Homestake Mine in South Dakota, near Lead, if you know where that is, which is also at 1,500 meters, not 2,400 meters, but the same idea. There's a big experiment in it that's going to take, build a big cavern. Cavern's filled with water, has photomultiplier tubes around the side of it. If you've ever seen these things, they're really impressive. So particles come in from somewhere, they hit particles of water, of H2O, they make light, and you can see the scattering of it. And from looking at the scattering of the particles, you can say something about the particles. And so that's the one in... I'm getting diverted here. Oh, there was one other thing. The one in the US is called the Long Baseline Neutrino Experiment. What comes if I do that? Anything? Hydrogen. Do they have a picture? Actually, they do have a picture by bugs here. So it's a very specific experiment, actually. It's kind of interesting. So this is Fermilab in Chicago. And so the idea is to be able to have, they have an accelerator, so they have a beam. So you shoot neutrinos through the Earth's crust to get to this underground lab in Leeds, South Dakota. And this 1,100 kilometers or something is just enough distance that the neutrinos, as you shoot them, can change flavor from one to another in that distance and then arrive at their destination to be able to test some hypothesis about why we have so much dark matter and dark energy in the universe, and the stuff we see is only 12% of the matter that we know of. And we know of the other stuff because the universe isn't flying apart far enough. So I think this is one of the big detectors. So at 1,500 meters below ground, you build a big cavern, you fill it with water, you put on the walls of this photomultiplier tubes to be able to sense little sparks of light in the water. And then when particles ricochet off other particles, the static water in the Cherenkov detector, you can say something about the particle physics, which is way beyond me. So that's about the limits of my understanding of that. And the last thing I wanted to show you was not in China, if I can do that. Won't do it. But back in old US of A, if I can, it's not manipulating very well. Ah, there it is. Look at this. Well, that's my wife. So at least she's got clothes on. That's good. Sorry. Oh, you've got to have a bit of humor, right? So we talked about this. So this is a pitot tube. So this is getting on the plane. One of the puddle jumpers we have arriving from Chicago. You know, you walk directly onto it. So it's a pitot tube facing forwards. You know, it has a hole in here. It kills the momentum of the air that it flows past. And I guess you know how these work. And it also samples the air pressure it flows past. But this is what we talked about. You know, the unfortunate lesson from the Air France flight from Rio to Paris, where the pitot tube froze up and the plane went through its hijinks and ultimately flew into the ocean. Unfortunately, with everyone lost. So that's same location, O'Hare Airport, but going to meet students on our New Zealand trip, I guess, last year. So, was that enough excitement for today? I'm carrying a cold from my travels. I asked the two people who are first here whether things went okay last week. Hope they did. We have another test, unfortunately, in the following week. I've mentioned before to you that wasn't my intention, but it was the times that we could get the testing center. I'm not absolutely enamored with the idea of the testing center. I'd be interested to get feedback from you guys in whatever has become the SRTEs. I think they changed this year, do you?
S-E-E-Q. Yeah. So.
What is it? Won't even ask what that acronym means. I don't care. But I do look at them, and they're always mixed for classes. The one thing I remember out of this class, which kind of drove the class, this was one person was really upset about the fact that there was lots of collusion going on in the tests. And so I decided to use the testing center specifically this year because of that. I'm not sure whether that's a good thing or whether you like it. I'm kind of ambivalent about it. After the experience with the first test, I don't know whether it's... I can think of ways to game the current system. You know, if I was wanting to game this system, in a group of people, we'd send us some probe in, you do the test, you know it's not going to be changing, you find out what the test is, you have that sacrificial probe, or you probe, or you send your best guy or gal in, and then you know what the questions are. So I don't know whether that happens or not, but... doesn't matter. So anyway, so unfortunately the next test comes next week, and the stuff's online, so you've seen it. It covers everything from week 9, which is dimensional analysis, to pipe flow. Really boring stuff, isn't it, pipe flow? But I was impressed when I looked at my videos from last year how wonderful they were, didn't you think? I think they're okay. I mean, I'm not being facetious, actually. I thought they're actually okay. Perhaps I'm being a bit too full of myself. So dimensional analysis, always a question on Buckingham Pi. It's a recipe, you can use it and to do some dimensional scaling. Pipe flows, there is a pipe flow, I can't remember what's on now. And I guess it stops at those 3 weeks. Doesn't include what we'll talk today. It doesn't include what we'd have talked in 11.3 for pipe networks as well. So, but that's all on the stuff. Okay, we done now? So I was going to do a recap since I looked at the stuff for 12.1 last time, and actually I didn't really like it so much. I thought the stuff up till that was okay. But I was going to do a recap on what we've talked about for the last 3 weeks, or you've looked at for the last week. And I was going to just do that from my notes and start off at week number 9. See if I can remember how to write. And so, yeah, so just to summarize these things. So dimensional analysis always surprises me. It's called dimensional analysis when it's really dimensionless. And actually, looking at those photos, we've covered a lot in this class, lots of interesting topics. Fluid mechanics is how our world works. And so I remember, you'll remember that you define a number of properties in terms of mass, length, and time. We always use mass, length, and time, not force, even though some of your homework examples will use that. You figure out what properties you have in your system, and we've looked at flow in pipes and a whole bunch of other things, and so you'll figure out what the units are that describe your system in terms of velocity and diameter and length and viscosity and density. And you figure out how many of these constraints you have and how many of these. The difference between them gives the number of pi groups. And what it basically boils down to fluid mechanics is that there are three important similitudes that we talked about. And they often work out to be similar, and they do for, you can use it in any branch of engineering or any branch of physical behavior you want. But for fluid mechanics, we have geometric similitude, which means that the dimensions of your model have to equal the dimensions of your prototype, or the non-dimensional dimensions, of the ratios of those. So if you have a plane, just shrink every single aspect of it down. Kinematic similitude, which is that the Reynolds number of the model has to equal the Reynolds number of the prototype. Reynolds number, we know, is a velocity, a characteristic length, and a density divided by a viscosity. And so this similitude means that if you look at the flow regime around your wing for external flows, or the flow regime inside the pipe, you saw a video of little turbulence occurring as you increase the velocity, then the flow regime has to be the same, and that's guaranteed by this. And then dynamic similitude. And that is that the Euler numbers for the model and the Euler numbers for the prototype are the same, and the Euler number is just this is ratio of inertial to viscous forces, this is ratio of pressure to inertial forces. Pressure we can always replace by a force divided by an area, which is equal to rho v squared, which is the other way to write this. And so the physical meaning of this is, you've seen it since then, you've seen it in pipe flows, is that if you think of pi 1, this might be, these are pi groups, so this is, let's call this pi 3, let's call this pi 2. And what this means is that if you have a physical system that's governed by just two pi groups, say it's flow, then you have just some relationship. And it might look like this, or it might look like this. It turns out that often the pi groups might be something like this. And for pipe flow, for instance, this pi group is actually this friction factor. That's really what it is. If you only have two pi groups, you only have a single relationship, so that if you go from doing your experiment at a given, I wanted it to be blue, if you're doing an experiment at a given Reynolds number, and it's the same for each of your model and your prototype, then it means that the Reynolds number is the same for model and prototype, and so the Euler number is the same for model and prototype. And so if you can link these two together, typically you'd measure a force in the model, and you'd use that to calculate a force in the prototype. And the force would be, not more interestingly than the internal force on a pipe, for a wing it would be the force, the uplift force, which is pulling you into the air. If you have three pi groups, then you might have a model that looks like this. And these are your Moody charts, right? So this is for epsilon over diameter, roughness to diameter. And this is for the magnitude, which is increasing. So this would be for zero. This would be for not zero. And so instead of just, and this would be the third pi group. And so these Moody charts, which we've used, are just an exposition, really, of this idea of dimensional analysis. You don't need to know what Navier-Stokes equations are. You just need to know what the properties that are controlling your system. And then if you use that, you can group parameters together. You have to know what the recipe is, otherwise you get different groups, which seems kind of contradictory. But you can always manipulate the different groups into the same groups, if you understand what I mean. And so always in the questions that you're given, you're told what the variables should be and how you use them to be able to guide you through, because there is a single answer that we want to score. But you don't have to do that in reality. So, you know, the other way to think about this curve is if you have two pi groups, pi 1 and pi 2, then you'd have a single relationship. If you have a third pi group, then perhaps you have a whole bunch of curves which represent, maybe this is length over diameter or something, so the third pi group. And so dimensional analysis is an incredibly a powerful tool to use. And so not just in, and the idea of it is to allow you to be able to do the minimum number of experiments to be able to define these relationships. So you don't need to choose viscosities from 0 to infinity, densities from 0 to infinity, and to do an infinite number of experiments. You can choose just combinations of these, which allow you to sample different magnitudes of the Reynolds number, which you think might be appropriate. And I guess the other thing that you know from this is that in terms of this behavior, I'm going to summarize it as well. This behavior here for flows in pipes is laminar behavior to the left of this and turbulent behavior to the right. And so, and you can parameterize these things. I won't redo that because you've spent week 10 and 11 basically doing that. Well, actually, I'm going to do it because I'm going to do week number 10 and 11. Questions before we move on? Just trying to give a bit of context. Feel an obligation to give kind of a big picture view of where we're going. We get down in the weeds a lot, but maybe it's useful to look beyond that. Week 10 and 11, you remember that we talked about the energy equation, which is Bernoulli equation, which you will well know. It has to be written from upstream to downstream in terms of these loss terms, pressure loss, and the same terms on the downstream side. And it has these important head loss terms. And so you can never remember which ones are major and which ones are minor. But I reminded myself last night, the minor ones are bends in pipes. So these ones are the ones that look like going around a bend. And you remember that they're given in terms of Darcy-Weisbach terms, which are the head loss is equal to a head loss coefficient, sometimes 1, but not always, times v squared over 2g. Has to be dimensionless, since this is units of length, so has to be dimensionless. And it really just says how severe the change in direction is, because an acceleration, which is what you use up your energy in, is not just a change in speed. The speed of this here and here might be the same, but an acceleration is directional. And so you're changing direction and you're using energy to do that. And the major losses are that you can use a friction factor, a length to diameter ratio of the pipe, and again, V squared over 2G. Units of length, non-dimensional, has to be non-dimensional. And of course, we've just drawn the Moody chart. Doesn't hurt to draw it again to make the point of what we're trying to do. And the story is that if you write Reynolds number, which you can write as velocity, an equivalent diameter, we talked about non-circular pipe sections, which would have an equivalent diameter, and a density, I guess, and a viscosity, ratio of inertial to viscous forces, an Euler number, which is also equivalent to a friction factor, and then the Moody charts look like this, which for a circular pipe is a friction factor equal 64 over Reynolds number, as I recall. And for a smooth pipe, this is for values of the roughness. This is zero along here. And as you go up here, they get progressively larger. These curves are always drawn on log space, log space. So this is epsilon over D equals bigger, I guess, as you go up, if that's not too simplistic. Yeah, and you know, these not so obvious for pipe flow, but we'll look at this for external flows. You know, these regimes are just that the flow regime for the laminar flow would look like this, and the flow regime for the turbulent flow would look like this. So that's all that's happening here. Again, this is a Reynolds number, and it demarks the distribution, the change from turbulent magnitudes above that and laminar below that. And so what you can do with this, as we attempted to explain, you can look at flows between tanks. I'm actually spending more time than probably I wanted to, but perhaps it's warranted. Drawing this figure. You know, if you want to make your life easy on this approximation, then you know that you'd write this equation from places where the velocities at locations 1 and 2 might be 0. So in other words, atmospheric pressure, 0 upstream velocity, atmospheric pressure, 0 upstream velocity, the differences in elevation, you know, just from the difference in these. And then the only things you have to worry about are these other things. And of course, this velocity is the velocity within the conduit. This would be within the pipe. So this is the major losses. They're very small incremental losses, and they're due to the fact that we have roughness in the pipe and friction acting against this flow. But because the pipe might be quite long, you know, a drill hole to Marcellus Shale is 3 kilometers, and the diameter might be 10 centimeters, tens of centimeters, then this number is pretty big. So even though this is small, this might be large, this is big. So these are major losses. And then I guess the other thing that we talked about in this was that we talked about the ability to solve problems in terms of knowing the geometry of a pipe, knowing the flow rates, and knowing the pressure head. I'm looking at my notes. Pressure or head, I guess. So those are the things that we solve for. So I guess for pipe flow, the geometry would be D, it would be length, it would be epsilon. The flow rates would be velocities or volumetric flow rates. And the pressures would be pressures or heads or head losses. And so my reason for doing this is that we talked about methods of solving these, and the easiest way to write that is the easiest solved solutions are the so-called type 1 problems, right? Because that means that you know the values of your pipes, you know the velocity it's flowing at, and so immediately you can calculate what the Reynolds number is, because it's equal to velocity times diameter times the properties of the fluids, which you hopefully know. And so you know velocity and diameter because you know each of these terms. And so these are by far the easiest ones to solve for because you don't need to solve by iteration. The so-called type 2 problems are where you want to solve for this. So this is where you're solving for the pressure or the head loss, and you know every other parameter. Type 2 problems are where you're solving for the velocity, and you know your pipe geometries, and you know kind of what your head losses should be, but you might not know them exactly, because the head losses might be a function of the velocity as well, which is what you're trying to find out. And then the most perplexing one, I won't go through them again, are the type 3 problems, where you want to solve for the geometry of the duct that you're pushing fluid through, and you want to know what how to dimension the duct to be able to get the flow rate that you want, and with the desired head loss, so the pump that you have can actually push it through. And so we talked about those three different classes of problems. This is the easiest, and these are only more difficult, these ones, because you have to iterate to a solution. And if you remember, the iteration was that you have to guess a value of the velocity, you use this velocity to get a Reynolds number, you use that Reynolds number to go to this chart to calculate a friction factor, and you use that friction factor to reconfirm your velocity. So Reynolds number going on to this, if you know the geometry, would give you a friction factor, which would just be the ordinate on this curve here. Some number, 0.01, whatever. You use this friction factor to then calculate what the velocity would be, perhaps by using these equations. And then with that velocity, you go back and you recheck your Reynolds number again. If you're lucky, then the Reynolds number that you calculate is exactly the same as you had before. If you're unlucky, it's a different Reynolds number, and you have to do it again. And if it's turbulent flow, then when you do it again, turbulent flow is independent of Reynolds number. So the different characteristics of these flows are that for laminar flow, it's a function of viscosity controls the flow. And for turbulent flows, density kind of controls the flow. And you can think of that kind of I can think of it much better in an external flow than an internal flow. But kind of the analog is this. So if you think about, if you're like me, a stupid aeronautical engineer, this is the aerofoil that you design. And so if you look at flow against this, you can imagine that laminar flow would happen like this. On either side. And so the big loss in this is due to the shear stress which is applied on this part of the wing. We're talking about drag, pushing it the wing through the air. And we know that that is given by Newton's law, dv dy. Right? This is viscosity. So as you increase the velocity, double the velocity, you double the drag. And so in this laminar regime where you have flow creeping around this, the loss in this system is due to the viscous drag in the system. So viscosity controls the behavior in this area. If you step up the velocity, then the flow regime you get, would look different from that. And if you come back to this, then the flow would look like this. And you don't know this yet, but we're going to find out this, perhaps not today, because I don't think we'll get to it, because I'm too busy talking garbage about something else, is that this would be the flow regime you'd get. This is in this regime. And it turns out that if you have this, if you looked at the velocity profile that you have here, I'll draw the turbulent flow velocity. This is versus Z. The flow velocity, if it was laminar, would look like this. Nice parabolic distribution, which is actually quite efficient at giving you lots of, if you think of a pack of cards, sliding the cards next to each other, as these cards slide next to each other, there's lots of friction that's taken up in this. This would be the laminar flow. If you look at turbulent flow, then this profile would actually look like this. You get a very thin boundary layer, which is right next door to the airfoil. And it's actually very efficient about, even though it's turbulent and jumbled, it's very efficient about not giving you much drag here. So the only drag that you get in this case is from the drop in big fluid pressure drop that occurs as you drive the flow against the front of this. This is our truck on the apron of San Francisco International Airport being blown over by the 747 or whatever. All of the drag on this is due to the killing momentum of the flow, and that is, of course, controlled by a half V squared over 2G. And of course, density goes in there somehow. It's not in Bernoulli because it drops out. But killing the velocity of the flow transfers all its momentum to this. And so the main portion that contributes to the flow resistance on this airfoil in the turbulent regime is due to the density, not due to the viscosity. And so that translates into a pipe in that in external flows and internal flows, we're interested in different things. Internal flows, we want to know what is the influence of this drag on the inside of the pipe on the water flowing through it, because it slows it down, and that's what our behavior is. And for an external flow, we're interested in what is the force that's applied to this external object by the flow which is around it, which isn't really changed very much a long way away from it, but has a big effect on this object, because we want to get maximum lift from an airfoil, or you want to have our bicycle helmet to have the minimum drag that's associated with it. Man, we're almost out of time. And so maybe I didn't get to where I wanted to today, but I'll close out with this. So the final thing that we talked about in week 11 and 3 was not single pipes, but multiple pipe networks. And so the networks were quite simply if we take this geometry and go from upstream to downstream, we did some examples. I really thought the videos were fantastic, even though hopefully you looked at them. I guess it doesn't close for Friday until this coming Wednesday. If you look at the upstream and downstream, then the flow regimes that we could look at came in three different flavors as far as I could see. And the flavors were a branch network, which looked like this. And so by definition for that branch network, the head loss in one and the head loss in two have to be the same as each other, because they both end up at the same pressure here. That's the rationale for that. And the head loss in three is independent of that. And so when you're looking at solving these networks, simple networks, we know that these head losses have to be the same, because the pressure at this point has to be the same at these terminations of both these pipes. And so it has to be the same in each of these. It doesn't have to be equally split between these, but that's the law that we have to abide by. The other networks that we had, if I just draw this in terms of upstream and downstream, were how to, yeah, parallel networks. So these are two pipes, and so the head loss in one and the head loss in two, again, these have to be equivalent to each other, because the upstream heads and downstream heads, the head loss across this system is the same, right? This is actually the head loss if there's zero velocity in these big tanks. So that's the rationale for that. And then the other one was by looking at a series flow. So this is parallel flow, this is series flow. And then the difference for this is that Q1 equals Q2 equals Q3, right? Just from what we know about continuity. And so if we know the volumetric flow rates, then presumably we can calculate the head losses if we know this. The velocity will change in this, right? It'll be a bigger velocity here than it is here, but the flow rate will be the same. So this would be V1A1 equals V2A2, etc. And so the velocity will change as you go downstream. And of course, if you plotted, again, if you look at the head losses across these systems between upstream and downstream, this would actually be the head loss. And of course, if you're summing these head losses for each of these velocities, you'd know that if this velocity is smaller, then the head loss in this pipe would be smaller. And so you'd probably expect that the slope in the heads as you go downstream would change from pretty shallow to steeper, to steepest as you go downstream. So these would be the changes in heads as you go down here. Head losses. So that's rationalizing that. And so I didn't mean to recover and go through everything, but that's kind of the big picture. And the reason for doing this is that this part of the class, dimensional analysis, minimum number equations, Reynolds number, Euler number, and geometric similitude are very powerful techniques to use in fluid mechanics, but aren't really just restricted to fluid mechanics. They cover groundwater hydrology and many other, and petroleum engineering for that matter, in things that you'll do in your other classes. It's useful to look at what we've talked about in terms of the Moody charts in terms of similitude. So geometric similitude means the pipe looks the same with the scaled roughness at all scales. So you do a small scale experiment and you can do it to the Nord Stream 2 pipeline if it hadn't been blown up by someone. Kinematic similitude is that you're running at the same Reynolds number. And if you're running at the same Reynolds number, the flow regimes are equivalent. And therefore, if the flow looks the same, then if you measure the force that occurs in a model, then you can calculate the same force in the prototype. For a pipe, the force you want to know would be the drag force on the fluid that's retarding it along its flow length. And for an external flow, it would be the force that's applied onto the structure, the Tacoma Narrows Bridge, the airfoil, the twin towers, all went into wind tunnels to be able to design them for the forces. And then we can do some other things with flows. So maybe next time I'll talk about where I wanted to get, which is comparing all of these things for the things that we'll do now. So pipe flow is done. I think it's super boring, but it's a recipe and it's formulaic. We'll find out that when we talk about external flows, we'll end up with a diagram that looks exactly the same as this. But instead of being a friction factor, we define things in terms of a coefficient of drag or a coefficient of lift, which allows us to say how much force is applied on the structure. And also in the final throws in topic 13, we'll talk about open channel flows, where you're running fluid down a ditch, and you're interested in the drag on the base of it, and we'll end up with a figure that looks like this. And the one thing I forgot to tell you about on my travels, which I have to absolutely tell you about, if I go back to my photos, hopefully everyone's got their clothes on, is also with this gravity arch dam on that same. No, it's actually it's not that one, but it's very close to it. It must be this one. No, it's this one. No, it's not that one. This is it. Some people doing some things, but let's not worry about that. This is the world's first irrigation system near Chengdu in western China, close to where the Himalayas hit China. And so this idea is that, I don't know, 1100 years ago, the rivers coming out of the mountains onto the Sichuan Basin Plain, which is a big shale gas region, just like Pennsylvania. They split the river with an artificial island. It flows on the other side of this river. And on this river, this is not it. They build these defenses out of bamboo and rocks to be able to divert it. They divert the river to be able to use it for irrigation and then put it into a bunch of channels, which I wonder if this is it. That's not it. This is it. This is a recreation of it, of course. And this is taking water for the first time out of a river. I don't know if this is true or not, because it also, you know, the cradle of civilization in Iraq, Mesopotamia, and the Tigris and the Euphrates, the big rivers that flow through there, was supposed to be the cradle of civilization. And certainly irrigation was used in the Middle East from these times. But anyway, that's the other fluid mechanics problem that was related to this. There's a world tour for you. Well, at least to two countries, the US and China. Exciting? All right, that's it for today. Well, good seeing you again. Thanks for turning up. I've been missing you. I'm sure you've been missing me. And we'll get together on Wednesday and we'll actually start talking about external flows. So I think it's useful to do this kind of gathering things into a big picture once in a while, which is really what we've done today. Give some perspective.